home, you can take hold in money, you can do that, or whatever you got, you can put in there. World Hunger and Task Appreciation Soup Sandwich, right after the preaching service here shortly, we'll go over, have soup, sandwich, and then about halfway through that, we'll probably have some type of little Task Appreciation service. Fifth Sunday singing next month, get your special ready. We will have a little finger food fellowship right after that. Next Saturday, if you would like to join us on the square in Carrollton around the courthouse, we will be passing out some candy for the trunk or treat at 5:30 p.m. If you'd like to make changes to your budget, see a member of the stewardship committee before the meeting on November the 2nd. At 6:30 p.m. And bylaws, there's a sheet out there. If you didn't get one Wednesday, get a sheet, one for family, please, and see what we're going to take up at the next business meeting. And also at 6:30 Wednesday, the deacons, if you could, we need to meet at 6:30 Wednesday night, right before prayer meeting for a little something. Anything else? Any more announcements? They're not here to sing to, are they? All right. Prayer list. Don Wiltshire, Don Austin, Jennifer Motsinger, Jimmy and Barbara Aban, Greg and Irene Winger, John and Norma Beckwith, Willie Ezell, Gary Beth Moore, Ben Shewing, Brenda Delap, Jane Chaney, Doug Walker, Teresa James, Laura Truitt, Unspoken, Ann Smith, Unspoken, Jim and Carla Bowen, excuse me, Gene Lester, Charles Acey, North Carolina Baptist Church, Christine Cervantes, Ann Chase, Wendell and Brennan Tennyson, Harold Wilson, Joyce Howell, and Beth Tingle. Anybody else need to add to that? Okay. Anybody else? Yeah, and Charles Asen. I got Charles Asen.
Yeah.
That's him? Okay. Anybody else? Billy Earl, would you lead us in the prayer for these, please?
My Father in heaven, thank you much for this day. Thank you for you. I'm glad to have that. God, I just pray to get through with you tonight. Do well together.
Everybody, our first song is going to be, you need to turn on the reverse picture, and on this screen here, Firm Foundation, hit the second screen, I'm going to just go over something here to make sure it's from that way. Put the next slide up. Sing the whole thing, no male and female parts. It's just all, it's a unisex. All right, y'all stand, join us as we sing.
Our congregation.
is a word of prayer. Service. Brethren, we have yet to worship number 379.
Take me over again, Lord, take me.
Thank you.
gonna try that one for y'all.
Well, I'll tell you, appreciate that. I really do. A lot of those pictures you saw were children, kids you didn't recognize. They were from my former church. And as I was looking at that, I thought, you know, I look forward to, in the future, those pictures would be of us here, of our church. I say our because it is. It's God's house, but it's ours. Before I was called to be your pastor, I had to refer to this as your church. But now, thankfully, I can call it ours. And so I'm glad to be able to serve as your pastor and alongside you and serving God in whatever capacity that he calls us to do. Sometimes that is difficult. Sometimes that does cause us to be a little uncomfortable. But nonetheless, God gives us exactly what we need, exactly when we need. Turn with me, if you would, to 2 Timothy chapter 3. And we'll begin there in verse 10, going through the remainder part of chapter 3 there. And a message entitled, According to the Scriptures. According to the Scriptures. Not according to a sermon. Not according to a tradition. Not according to something that's man-made, but rather according to the Scriptures. Now, I have to remind you that the Scriptures, although written in a book form, a collection of 66 books written by many different authors, listen to me, God is the author of the Bible. Amen. He inspired it. He gave the words and inspiration. People say, well, this book was left out, and this book is incomplete, and this book here has been found, and it should be added. Friend, I believe the Bible is complete from cover to cover, from Genesis to Revelation. And so, having said that, I want to ask you if you would to follow along with me in your reading of God's Word. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 10. But you have carefully followed my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, love, perseverance, persecutions, afflictions, which happened to me at Antioch, at Iconium, and Lystra. What persecutions I endured, and of them all the Lord delivered me. Verse 12, yes. And all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus, listen to me, will suffer persecution. Let me read that verse to you again. Verse 12. Yes, and all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. But evil men and impostors will grow worse and worse, deceiving and be deceived. But you must continue in the things which you have learned and have been assured of, knowing from whom you have learned them. And that from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation, through faith which is in Christ Jesus. And in verse 16 says, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for these words of Scripture, how they remind us, Lord, that your word is complete. And through that word, Lord, we can come to us the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, but also through that word, we can grow in our faith in you. And we can, in turn, use that Scripture, Father, to lead other people, not to the church, but to the foot of the cross. And Father, we are forever grateful to you for that. And Lord, how you've given it to us. And Lord, how it's endured. Many times it's been trying to be destroyed, taken away and silenced and burned, but Father, your word endures. And because of that, we can glean from it. We can hold true to it. Father, I thank you for that. Lord, we love you and we praise you. And we thank you, Father God, for who you are and for what you mean to us. Father, I ask and pray these things in Jesus' name. As we look at this section of Scripture, we see that Paul is again continuing to encourage young Timothy through his ministry, through God's ministry through him. And he reminds him, you're going to face persecution. He says, if you're a follower of God, if you are a godly person in Christ, you will suffer persecution. Church, I'm here to tell you today, even in our 21st century, with all the things and technology and all of the woos and wows of society, you, if you are a child of God, if you are a godly person in Christ Jesus, listen to me, you will suffer
persecution. If you're here tonight and you say, well, I've never experienced that, Pastor. Well, maybe you haven't been living for Jesus, amen? Because when you live for Jesus, you're going to be ridiculed, mocked, excluded, and on and on and on and so forth. But the Bible tells us, in the Bible, that we will have trouble. Jesus said himself, but we can rely upon him. Now, Paul here is writing a letter, and he lists the list of things that we're going to face and experience. Well, who better to know about persecution and affliction than Paul? We find in Scripture a list of his sufferings, of his persecutions, and of his afflictions. And he certainly knew persecution. But he wants us through his letter to deal with the truth of persecution and how we must stand firm, church, on our faith and beliefs in God and his word. It's the Bible. It's God's holy word. We went on our trip just last week, and I don't want to include that in my message tonight. That's not what I want to do. But what I want to share with you is we were there in the room, and I began to think, and I wondered, and I praise God. I know we have one amongst us, and I'm not doing this to dishonor, but I praise God for Gideon's. And I was in that room, and I began to think, I wonder if there's a Bible in this room. I knew there was one in there because I had mine. But I began to wonder. And then I began to get nosy. I began to open up drawers. We hadn't got too far out of the south. And I finally opened up the drawer of the nightstand on the side of the bed where I was sleeping. There on that top shelf of that drawer, there sat that Gideon Bible. God's holy word. And when I think about the Bible and God's holy word, how it reminds us that God is in, listen to me, not just in control, listen to this, but he's in total control. That's in every area, every situation, everything that happens in life, and even in the times when we don't understand and we stand there scratching our heads or gazing into heaven thinking, what's God doing? God is still in control. And Paul here was also not only encouraging him, Timothy, but he was encouraging us as his readers to continue in the truth that we know and that we were taught. How do we know that? How are we taught that? Friend, you're here as evidence of this. Somewhere in your life, probably many times, someone invested in you. Probably it was your parents. If not, maybe your grandparents. If not, it was probably a neighbor. Or I might even go a step further and say a Sunday school teacher, maybe an RA director, or maybe a GA director, or maybe even before that, some kind of children's leader that helped you, to show you. It helps you to learn about the Bible and to learn the books of the Bible. Why is that so important? So that we can go to the Bible drill convention and show off for our church? Or so that we can get to heaven and say, I know the books of the Bible. I can say it faster than anyone here. No, it's because we know the Word of God. And so when someone takes it and twists it, or Satan himself takes it and twists it, we say, wait a minute, that's not what the Bible says. How do I know that? Because I know what the Bible says. So we have to continue in the truth, church, of what we believe. Here's the way I want to share it with you tonight. Know what you know and believe what you believe. Now let me explain that. Know what you know, okay? Well, I know that's what they told me, so that's what I know. Paul said you need to work out your own salvation. He didn't say work for. He said work out your own salvation. You know, before my children came to know the Lord, I wanted them to get saved. The most important thing they could ever, the decision they could ever make. I wanted them to get saved, and I wanted them to learn how to swim. And then I wanted them to meet their forever mate. Those were three very important things to me in their life. So what about the swimming part? Well, that's important. Most important is they come to know Jesus. But I couldn't do it for them. It was a decision that they had to make. So know what you know and then believe not what someone has taught you to believe.
that's important. That's how you get to where you're going. But believe what you believe, because you've worked out your own salvation. You know that Christ Jesus died for you as a sinner. He died for me as a sinner. And I believe that, not because that's what someone told me to, rather because that's what God inspired me. This evening, I want us to look very quickly. First of all, let's see the suffering in verse 12. Let's go back and read verse 12. Brother, let's back up and let's begin in verse 10. But you have carefully followed my teaching, if you will. My manner of life, this is Paul talking about himself to Timothy. My purpose, my faith, my long-suffering, my love, my perseverance. But then also, verse 11, he says, persecutions, afflictions, what's happened to me in several different places. At Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra, which persecutions I endured. And notice what he says, and out of them all, what? He didn't say I made it through, did he? He didn't say I grabbed myself up by my bootstraps and I mustered up enough strength. He says, but the Lord delivered me. Yes, and all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecutions. The church sufferings are certain for the Christian. When you live for Christ, you will face persecution. You will suffer. You will be made fun of. You will be called names. You will be excluded from events and occasions and happenings. You will be referred to as many things. And as long as Christ tarries on his return, and as dark as this world is getting, we're going to face more and more and more sufferings and persecution. Now, I stand before you and say, that's not popular preaching. If I were preaching to fill up pews, would say, hey, it's all going to be okay. You just got to love God, love everybody, and everything's going to work out the way. Sometimes we suffer, don't we? Sometimes I think it seems like the Christians sometimes suffer more than the world because Satan's not after them. Why? Because he's not working like them. They're not trying to serve God. They're serving themselves. Someone once asked C.S. Lewis, why do the righteous suffer? And his reply was, why not? They're the only ones who can take it. We are righteous not because of who we are, but listen to it, but because of whose we are. I got myself right, and I made myself righteous. The Bible says our righteousness is as filthy rags. Also, there's none righteous, no, not even one. The way that we're made right in the sight of God is through the precious blood of Jesus. Jesus said in John chapter 16, verse 33, these things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. He said, in the world you will have tribulation, you will have trouble, you will have persecution, you will have sufferings, but be of good cheer, Jesus says, for I have overcome, what? The world. The world, the system, the way that everything happens and the way that we live and breathe and even in our society. Jesus said, I have overcome the world. Well, see, persecution comes from a life that is lived to please God rather than man. See, God had not delivered from trouble, but rather he had delivered out of. How did he do that? It's because he went to. He was there with. We don't face persecution and suffering on our own, do we? You say, no, I've got my family. I've got my church family. That's not what I'm talking about. That's not all. We don't face these things alone because we have God by our side. Even if our family and our loved ones, even if our church family forsakes us, we still have God. His word says he will never leave us nor forsake us. We're not promised freedom from difficulties, but we are promised that the Lord will be with us and see us through. The story was told of early one morning. This particular wife said her husband works at a funeral home, and he woke her up. And he was complaining of severe abdominal pain. So it goes on to say that we rushed to the emergency room where they gave him a series of tests to determine the source of the pain. The husband had decided with his wife not to call in sick yet until they found out what was going on and what was wrong. Remember, he worked for the funeral service. So when the results came back, the nurse informed them that, true to their suspicions, he was suffering from a kidney stone. The wife turned to her husband and asked, now, would you like for me to call the funeral home? The nurse quickly said, ma'am, he's not that sick. See, sometimes we suffer. Sometimes we suffer beyond what man could understand. And then sometimes we suffer with kidney stones. Amen. Suffering and persecution are an integral part of a devout Christian life. Notice here what he said. He said, you carefully followed my doctrine, my teaching, my manner of life, my purpose, my faith, my long suffering. In other words, you knew who I was. You saw me. And so as a mentor in your life, Timothy, Paul says, you followed many of those things. Who was Paul following? Paul met the road to Damascus, his Lord and Savior. So he used a phrase in one of his letters. He said, imitate me, what? As I imitate, not another man, another person, another place, or another thing. He said, but imitate me as I imitate God. Suffering. I would be amiss if I shared with you that we're not going to suffer. That God's going to just wipe it away. And at some point, he's going to. But because of his promise, he says, you will suffer. Second thing I want us to see in verse 15 is the salvation. Notice here, reading verse 15, and that from your childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures. Pause right there because we've got to remind ourselves that they didn't have all 66 books bound in leather edition, right? Because this is one of the letters that Paul was writing to Timothy. So what did he have? You remember in Scripture that his mother and his grandmother had been mentioned in Scripture. So how do you think he had the Scriptures? It was probably right here. Listen to me. Look at me. Even more important than being here, he had it right here. How was that so? They had shared it. But not only had they shared it, what? They had lived it out for him. Follow along with me in reading. And then from childhood, you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for what? For salvation. But how is it? Through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. See, salvation, church, can only come from Christ. In the book of Acts, chapter 4, verse 12, it says, nor is there salvation in any other. For there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. There's no other name that we can cry out to. There's no one else that went to the cross because there's no one else that could have gone to the cross because Jesus went as a perfect see, faith in Christ leads us to salvation. How do we learn the way of salvation? Through the Bible. What did Jesus say? I'm the what? The way. How do we know that way? How do we come to know Jesus? It's through someone sharing of that message. It's from the Holy Spirit coming upon us and convicting us, first of all, of our sins, and we recognize and understand that we are a sinner in need of a Savior. That requires humility. Arrogance says, I don't need forgiveness of sins because I've never sinned that much. Surely there's nothing that I've done in my life that would have caused Jesus to have to go to the cross. Friend, sin in the face of God is sin. No matter how big, how little, how secret, how private, or how public sin is, sin nailed Jesus to the cross. And the only way through salvation is through the precious blood that Jesus shed for us. See, also, God's word not only is for salvation, but it's also vital for Christian faith. I read the Bible with assurance. the Bible with confidence. I read the Bible to not only to come to know Christ, but also to grow in my faith, to grow in a closer walk with Him, to know and understand more about Him. You ever read the Bible? I know you have, but you read it and you said, I've never seen that before. Why is that? Because it's inspired by God. Maybe it's because He didn't reveal it to you before. But as you grew in your faith, He revealed more and more and more and more. That's because His Word is inspired. See, it's important that we know that we have salvation. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 13, I like this verse. This is assurance right here, one verse, 1 John chapter 5, verse 13. These things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may continue to believe in the name of the Son of God. I like the way that it says the word know there. Because what that is that's a fact, okay? That's not saying, well, these things I know, I think. If you were to die at this very moment, where would you go to spend eternity? Well, I think I would go to heaven. Well, I hope I would go to heaven. I sure don't want to go to hell. I think that I'm okay with Jesus. I think I was at church Sunday and I took a few notes. I think I'm going to be okay. Jesus didn't die on the cross for you to hope and wish and think and go to a place and flip a quarter or a dime or a penny or a nickel into a well and say, I hope I can go to heaven when I die. But rather, He died on the cross, friend, so that we can know without a shadow of a doubt. That is a fact. That is a fact for certain. This young gentleman had started a new job at a gas station. And he had watched one of the senior co-workers measure the level of gas in the underground tanks. He would take the top off the tank and he would lower down a stick and he would bring it up, he would see the level of fuel in the tank by the measuring of the stick. He asked the new co-worker there, he said, what would happen if I lit a match and threw it into the hole? He said, well, it would go out. The co-worker knew the job and knew the position. He said, really? He said, how is that? He said, is there a lack of oxygen or is there some sort of safety device that would extinguish before the flames ignited? He said, no. The force from the explosion would blow out the match. See, that's a fact as well. Another fact I share with you is that even today, the pool in the Titanic is still full of water. Now see, those are some facts, but friend, I don't want to just share those kind of facts with you tonight. I want to share the fact that God loves you, sent His Son Jesus to die for you, and if you recognize yourself as a sinner and Him as your Savior, you will inherit eternal life. And friend, that is a fact. Not something that I've heard, not something that I've thought about, but friend, that is something that God has shared with us through His Holy. God wants us to have confidence in our salvation. Now, third and finally, I want us to look at the Scriptures. I said third and finally because that's the way you kind of let people know you're wrapping up. I'm not. Because we're really just now getting into look at me on the nitty gritty, okay? Let's look at verse 16 here. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God. And we can just stop right there. Now that would be sufficient, amen. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God. But here's some more facts to back that up. And is profitable for doctrine. Now that's teaching. For reproof. For correction. For instruction in righteousness. That the man of God may be, here's that word from this morning, complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. I want to ask you a very simple question. It's test time, okay? My teachers used to tell me, put on my thinking caps. I'm still looking for that thing. I don't know where that thing is. How much Scripture is all Scripture? You scripture is all scripture. Is that all? Or is that just some? Or is that just the New Testament? Or is that just the ones I like? If we've all got our favorite books, don't we? We've all got our favorite, text, and we know some that we really like to read, and it helps us to cope with life and help us to feel good and to bring us back to a positive light. But sometimes we read those scriptures and we say, ouch, woo, get back. I don't want to read that anymore. In our Sunday school class, we've been kind of doing some things with our young people, and we've been sort of taking some topics, and we've just been kind of unpacking them. And the last couple of weeks, we've been looking at the Ten Commandments. And the idea of the Ten Commandments is we're honest before God, we've broken all ten of them. So who do you kill, preacher? What you been stealing? You mean you haven't been unfaithful to you, right? Where does sin begin? So if I'm honest before you and God, and you're honest this evening as well, we've all broken every one of the Ten Commandments. So I can look at that and say, I don't like Exodus chapter 20. I'm going to tear it out of my Bible. And I'm going to go to some other places in scriptures I don't understand, and I'm going to tear that out of my Bible. And I don't really pay much attention to this part, so I'm going to tear it out of my Bible. And I don't want to think about the end, so I'm going to tear it out of the Bible. So I'm just going to leave 150 or so pages of the scriptures that I like, and I'm going to call that inspired. I take that to mean, and this is very, very simple, but sometimes that's the way I mean, all of scripture means just that. All scripture is given by inspiration from God. Scripture here refers to the writings of God's Word. In the Greek, that word there is for scripture is grapha. I'm probably not saying that right. I don't speak elegant Greek. I don't want to. You can mix up my English, so forgive me. I'm not a Greek scholar, nor do I claim to be. But what that word means is the writings of God. Now, let me read you what the author of Hebrews wrote in Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 12. He says, for the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the division of soul and spirit and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. So let's back up and let's talk about that first part again. For the word of God is living and powerful. What's the difference in living? Well, let me ask you. What's the difference in being alive? Being dead. Okay? That's another one of those questions. It's pretty simple. So, well, if the Word of God is living, it's not dead. It's what? It's alive. So it's very much applicable to today's times and today's society. People say, well, the Bible's old, and what has it got to do with the 21st century? Friend, I read a lot of the Bible, and it applies every day. A lot of times it looks like the same as the front pages of the newspaper. We read about the promises of Christ's return and then what's going to happen before that takes place. And it's lining up pretty good to see that all those prophecies have been fulfilled. And so when I read and understand that the Word of God is living and powerful, I believe it's complete enough in and of itself that I need not take away, watch this, nor add to. You've got exegesis, what's taking out of Scripture, and then you've got eisegesis, which is trying to put something into Scripture. Neither do I never want to take away from Scripture, nor do I want to add to Scripture to make it fit me and to make it make me feel warm and fuzzy. Friend, sometimes the Bible doesn't make us feel either. Let us feel convicted of our sins. Then at the same time, God reminds us, I am with you. I will never leave you. I have overcome the world. Greater is in you than he who is in the world. And I'm reminded of those facts and of those truths. And that's not just something that I think, and that's not just something, stay with me, that I was told, but that's something that I have seen come. God has shown up and shown out in my life many, many times. So the Word of God, first of all, is inspired. You know this. I want to share this with you because it means that it's God-breathed. When I understand that the Word of God is inspired, it means that God communicated His Word to men and led them to write it down for permanent preservation. There have been many men that tried to destroy the Bible and to try to make it go away and to try to take it out of people's homes and to try to pile them up and burn them and to try to do away with them. But friend, I know because of God's Word being inspired, they will live through the test of time. So the writers of the Bible didn't just give their own private interpretations, but they wrote the messages which God gave. So the Word of God is inspired, and you also know that the Word of God is inerrant. Notice in verse 16 the word doctrine. What that word literally means is teaching. Well, what that word literally means is according to, watch this, not only according to the Scriptures, but according to God. You ever heard somebody misquote the Bible? And then maybe you didn't call them out on it. Maybe they did it out of error. Or maybe they did it because they felt like it needed to fit where they were in their life. When I read and understand the Bible, that it's inerrant, that it means it's incapable of being in error, and it is according to God, I don't need to add to it or change it or contradict it. Rather than try to take it and twist it to wrap it around my life, why don't I take my life and mold it to make it like God? But then you know also, not only is it inspired and not only is it inerrant, but you know this. Also infallible. Notice the word there in verse 16, the word correction. You know, we've all got those scriptures that we like. And we often turn to the book of Psalms and Proverbs and we read those words and it reminds us of those truths. But then there's also those words that we read and they convict us of our sins. And they show us the error of our ways. And we see the error of our land, and we see the error of man, and it convicts us. All the Hebrews said is it is a discerner of the heart. It says that it is piercing, even to the division of soul and spirit. Sometimes God's word will take and open us up and reveal not to man, but to us who we truly are, in order for us to fall on our face before Almighty God and say, Father, forgive me. I failed you, and I failed others around me, and maybe somebody saw me doing that. Father, for that I am forever sorry. Here's the thing about God: He will forgive us, to remind us, to remove our transgressions, as the Word of God says, as far as the east is. Absolutely trustworthy. I can read the Bible and know that God inspired the Word. Sometimes I read it and I don't fully understand. Sometimes I read it and there's words that I can't really pronounce. Sometimes I read it and I see something I didn't see before. Sometimes I look at it and I say, well, I missed that once before. I've read that before, but I never saw it. And I'm reminded that it's because God is using His Word to speak to us as His people. So here's where I'm going to bring us to a close, a question. Is will you trust God in His Word? Will you trust God in His Word for everything that you need in life? And the answer to that is by saying that I will turn to God and His Word in everything, for everything, about everything, when I'm in the middle of something that I can't figure it out, God and His Word will turn us to hearts. You trust God and His Word for everything that you need in this life and what comes. Father, we pray. Father, once again, we come to you thanking you for who you are. And Lord, for what your Word is and what it means to us and how we can read it and even apply it to our life every day. The world will look at it and say, well, the Bible is old and it's out of date. And it was written so many years ago, and it doesn't apply today. God, we know as your children, we know that it applies every day, every moment. And Father, we can glean from it how to trust in you for, first of all, for salvation. But then how to continue to trust in you. To walk in our faith, to be made complete and whole in you. Not in something that we've been taught and we believe because that's what everybody else said and what everybody else did, but rather we know that we know that if your word calls it sin, then we must call it sin as well. Father, I thank you for that truth. I thank you for how your word is inspired, is it air, is it valid. Father, how we take it, use it, heed it, apply it. Not just when it feels right, when it's convenient, but Father, in every area and every aspect of our lives. I pray, God, that you would remind us of that day, even in a time where things around us look very grim, we can trust you. Father, because of that, we are very grateful. Forgive us of our